This morning's reading is from Luke chapter 3, verses 7 to 18. And it's speaking about John the Baptist and his message. John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance, and do not begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham for our father.' I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe has been laid to the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire." "What should we do then?" the crowd asked. John answered, "Anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none, and anyone who has food should do the same." Even tax collectors came to be baptized. "Teacher," they asked, "what should we do?" "Don't collect any more than you are required to," he told them. Then some soldiers asked him, "And what should we do?" He replied, "Don't extort money, and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay." The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them, "I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." And with many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed the good news to them.
I bet you're glad you don't have a preacher that starts with, "You brood of vipers." This is about change, really. I'll explain that. There's a lovely quote about change. "Life hasn't got a remote control. Get up and change it yourself." So we're continuing the story about John the Baptist. Amanda began the story last week, and she introduced us to the man who God appointed to get the people ready for the coming Messiah, to get people ready for Jesus. An unconventional, uncompromising brood of vipers, man who lived in the desert, wore funny clothes, and ate even funnier food. And his message was, "Get ready for the king." Amanda reminded us last week that when a king came, they made the road up nice and smooth, filled in the potholes, evened out the bumps. And she reminded us we have a Saviour who can sort out the holes we fall into during our life and the blocks that we can't easily get round, including the depressions that sink us and the fears that stop us in our tracks. So what else does John the Baptist in the rest of this chapter that Penny read for us, what else does he say about getting ready for Jesus? Because we need to remember in Advent, it's not about getting ready for Christmas, as we've already sung, it's about getting ready for Jesus. Christmas will come and it will go, the presents and the mince pies and all the rest of it. But if we're not ready for Jesus, then we've missed the entire point. So, verse 8, first of all, it's not, says John, about looking back. He had some people there who were harking on about their ancestry. We have Abraham as our father. The Jews were, and still are, rightly proud of their ancestry, heritage, whatever you want to call it, but you can't inherit a relationship with God. And being a descendant of Abraham didn't of itself give them any claim to be right with God, any more than being brought up in a Christian home makes you a Christian. John is pretty uncompromising. Don't even go there. Don't even begin to think that way. Because if God wants to, he can take these stones. They were in the desert. There were plenty of stones around. He can take these stones and make children out of them. Well, it's a metaphor. But put it the other way around, they might as well have been stones. They were fossilized. They were stuck in the past. They remembered the past, and it had become the same old story, a fossil. John shifted the metaphor. They were very good at remembering the past, but there was no longer any fruit, which is a measure of how we've been listening to God. In a spiritual sense, I mean, spiritual fruit. It's an important question because, as he says, every tree that does not produce fruit will be cut down. Amanda reminded us that repentance that John was talking about actually means a change of direction. It's not feeling sorry. Repentance is not feeling sorry, although that helps move you forward. It's not even enough to profess that you know you need to change. Although that's really good, it's the second step in the whole process. Repentance means the change itself. A change of mind is what it literally means. I told you this is about change, this chapter. A change of mind leading to a change of behavior. And then John spoke in detail to the people who asked. What should we do then? Tell us about... They must have lost moral sense to some extent, I think, because they were asking the question, well, what should we do? As if they didn't kind of know what the Ten Commandments said, for example. Kind of strange, isn't it? Anyway, he said, you've got plenty. Share your wealth. Amazing that people need to be told that. I need to be told that. And to the officials of the empire, don't use your position to your own advantage. Oops, does that ring a bell? Things haven't changed much, have they? And to the military, the police, don't make false accusations to prop up the law. Oops, things haven't changed much. So here was John, dressed like Isaiah. I thought of acting that and then decided against it. Dressed like Isaiah, quoting Isaiah, prepare the way of the Lord. Totally uncompromising, you brood of vipers. So unsurprisingly, some of them began to ask, is he the Messiah? Is he here? Is this him? Is this the one we've been waiting for all the time? Wow. And I guess they're getting a bit excited talking about it. The Christ is here, Jesus, the Saviour. They listened to John and thought, he's right, he's got it right. That's exactly what we need to do. We need to repent, change our mind, change our behaviour. And if we could really do that, the world would be a great place, wouldn't it? Yeah, wouldn't it? Is he the Messiah then? He knows everything, he's got it right, he's quoting scripture, he's passionate, he's a bit weird, but he's definitely uncompromising, and maybe that's what we need. And is this the one? Lots of people get that far, in a sense. They know what's wrong, and they get as far as resolving, making resolutions to change, but they know in their hearts, we know in our hearts, that it's a very big mountain to climb, and they get nervous and they back away, and we get nervous and we back away. Try it for one day. Try to be perfect. Speak to others gracefully. Do the right things, don't do the wrong things. Sounds okay so far? Don't even think the wrong things. Don't even react inside in the wrong way. Oh dear. Don't react, don't let your emotions get the better of you, even on the inside. Don't let what's happening in your life affect your belief and your trust. And that's the first day. And if you get that right, do the same on Monday. And then on Tuesday, and then on Wednesday, and then for the rest of your life. You know, I know, and the people that listened to John knew as well. It's a big mountain, which is where John throws the key to it all in. No, says John, that's not it. I am not the Messiah. I'm just a voice calling in the desert. Straighten out your lives. I'm just the one preparing the way, the ground. It's the one who's coming that matters. I just baptize with water. It's a sign of a desire to change, a commitment to change even. But, the one who's coming after me, in brackets, whose shoelaces I am not worthy to untie. That's a reference to the fact that he saw himself as a lowly servant whose job in those days was to take the shoes off the great and the good when they arrived home. The one who's coming, whose shoelaces I am not worthy to untie, he will baptize in the Holy Spirit and with fire. Jesus. You see, where their resolutions were, our resolutions, their strength, our strength, determination will fall and fail, Jesus, by baptizing us in the Holy Spirit, will make sure that we succeed. That's the joy, the grace. Joy, yes, joy. That's the joy, the grace, the genius of our God. John drenched, that's, by the way, what baptize means. It's come to have a religious meaning, hasn't it? Obviously it has, because we do that so often, but it just means to drench. It means to saturate. John drenched people with water, immersed them. They came up dripping. Jesus, the one who comes after, drenches your life and mine with the Holy Spirit, saturates us with God himself, until as we walk around, we leave little pools of Jesus everywhere we step. Do you want to do that? Everywhere you step, there's a wet patch of Jesus that you've left behind, because you're so saturated with God, and no amount of human determination and no amount of resolutions, New Year or otherwise, no amount of resolutions can do that for you. It's just not possible. And just not to leave out the reference to fire, he baptizes with fire, which burns up the rubbish that has no constructive use in our lives whatsoever, with heavenly fire, purifies us, is the image that we have there. That's the good news. That's the good news about Christianity. It's not a try harder religion. There are plenty of those. Don't even think about going there. There are plenty of religions where you have to try hard to succeed. Christianity is not one of them. It's a wonderful partnership, you and God working together to restore in your lives what the devil took away in Eden. In Romans 12, verse 2, Paul says, "Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." Here we are with the mind again. Remember, repentance, change of mind. "Be transformed," says Paul, "by the renewing of your mind." The word transformed is a very powerful word. It's the same word that the gospel, I'm getting excited. It's the same word that the gospels use when they talk about the transfiguration of Jesus, where he appeared on a mountaintop with Moses and Elijah talking with them, and his whole being was transfigured. It says he was shining white in that particular instance, but transfigured is the word Greek. We have to have a bit of Greek, that's okay, isn't it? It's the word metamorphoso, from which we get metamorphosis. Butterflies are metamorphosed grubs, aren't they? Get a little grub, little caterpillar, green, black, brown, wriggly. I shouldn't say they're not attractive, should I? But you know what's coming, don't you? And one day that little grub goes into a chrysalis. And inside, even something, I mean, this is about a creator God, something to, literally amazing happens. All the cells of the DNA melt down into a goo. and God reconstructs the goo into a beautiful butterfly. Wow! Metamorphosis. So there are two changes in this story. There is changing our mind, which is metanoia in the Greek, repentance, and there is transforming our mind, metamorphosis, which is only possible through the Holy Spirit. We do one, God does the other. Can't be done any other way. That's the Christian message. That's the good news on this day that God wants you to hear from this story. So, if Jesus came back on 25th of December, well, we don't know when he's coming back, do we? If he came back on the 25th of December, would we really be ready? Or would we just be very, very busy? And what you and I need to do between now and then is to make sure that we have not only owned the holes we fall into and the blocks that prevent us living the life that God has given us, but have invited the Holy Spirit to transform our lives into the likeness of Jesus. Then we'll be ready. And I pray that you and I will have the courage to take up his offer.